Morning, church. So stand our feet. We're going to go for the Lord in prayer. We're going to have a great morning this morning. So Lord, we just thank you right now for your presence in this place, Father. And we just thank you we can come together in unity just to praise you, to worship you, and to honor you, Lord. But we just thank you for the word brought forth by Pastor Col this morning, that it will touch people and change people. People will not leave this house the same because of you, Father. So we thank you that we can come together and praise and worship your holy name. And everyone said, Amen. We've waited.
We've waited for this day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see. A mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise.
Hey! Your presence
in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Your glory like a cloud. Us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart.
show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. A mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. And open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise.
From your heart
and flowing from your heart.
Thank you, Lord. Amen, Lord. Thank you, Father. Lord, we're here just to lift you up this morning. We raise our hands, Lord. We just thank you, Father, for your presence in this place. Thank you, Jesus. We honor you this morning. Thank you, Father. Shut up.
In the name of the Lord, your holiness, and all I am will bless you. My hope is in the name of the Lord, where my help comes from. You're my strength, my song. My trust is in the name of the Lord. I will sing your praise. You are faithful. My hope is in the name of the Lord. Where my help comes from, you're my strength, my song. My trust is in the name of the Lord. I will sing your praise. You are faithful, faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. So faithful, Lord. You are faithful. You are faithful, it's in my heart. My hope is in the name of the Lord. Where my help comes from, you're my strength, my song. My trust is in the name of the Lord. I will sing your praise. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. This is my hope. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong,
in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil.
place, Lord of this nation. We lift you up as you so rightly deserve, Father, because you are Lord. Oh, we thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus.
Took my tears, took my shame, you washed them all away. Your love shines down on this heart of mine. Lead me to the waters of eternal life. I once was lost, now I'm found. It's a brand new day, and your love, it amazes me. Your love has lifted me higher than I can possibly dream. Your love amazes me. On my knees, on my knees, I bow down. Sing about the healer and the hope I found. You took my tears, you took my shame, you washed them all away. Your love shines down on this heart of mine. Lead me to the waters of eternal life. I once was lost, but now I'm found. It's a brand new day, and your love, it amazes me. Your love has lifted me higher than I can possibly dream. Your love amazes me. Your love, your love, it amazes me. Your love has lifted me higher than I can possibly dream. Your love amazes me. Me. Your love amazes me.
Got a plan for you. Yes, I have. I've got a plan for you. Yeah. Don't let your humanity stop you from opening your spirit today. Because I've got a plan for you, says the Lord. Open your ears. I want to talk to you. Open your eyes, your spiritual eyes. There's so much more to see than this realm you're living in, says the Lord. Open your eyes. Come on now. Open your eyes. Visions and dreams that I've given you, I've given them to you, and I've never taken them back, says the Lord. Because I've got a plan for you. I've got a plan for you. I have not forgotten you, says the Lord. I haven't forgotten you. The gifts of God are given without repentance, and I've never taken them back. I've given them unto you. I've given them to you. So it's time to dust them off, says the Lord. Some of them are in an old cupboard. I want you to dust them off. I want you to bring them out. And I want you to begin to move in the things I've given you, says the Lord. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter how long ago I made the promise to you. I want you to fulfill your destiny in me, says the Lord. Today is your day of restoration, says the Lord. I want to see you rise up. I want to see you rise up, because I've got a plan for you. I've got a plan for you that goes beyond anything you've ever dreamt of, says the Lord. Come on, I want you to move with me, says the Lord. This is the time. This is the time. This is the time. Come on, I've got a plan for you. I've got a plan for you, and it won't go away, says the Lord. This is your day. This is your time. I've made you with a backbone of steel. I've made you a generation to stand up from the inside out. And I've got a plan for you, says the Lord. Now I want you to get into my presence. I want you to come into my presence. I want you to get into my presence, and you're going to have peace. You're going to have what you've been longing for. You're going to have shalom, nothing missing, nothing broken. And from that, we're going to move on into the things that I have for you, says the Lord. We're going to move on. We're going to move on. And I promise you, says the Lord, that when you look for me, I'm going to be like a heat-seeking missile. I'm going to find you. I'm going to find you because this is your time. This is your day. Come on. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. I want you to stand up and I want you to grab hold of that hope, says the Lord. I want you to grab hold of that dream afresh, says the Lord. This is your day. This is your day. I've got a plan for you. 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 And it's a plan for good and not evil, says the Lord. I haven't forgotten you. I haven't forgotten you. I haven't forgotten you. I've got a plan. I've got a plan for you.
Just tell him, church. His love for you is amazing. It's awesome.
Hallelujah.
We're overwhelmed by his goodness, his grace. He's the most wonderful, wonderful person. And he's calling you into his presence. Just be amazed. Be overwhelmed as you lift your hands and just sing hallelujah to him.
Love amazes me.
That he would lay down his life just for you. Sing that, Bobby. Would you just come and just come stand there for me, darling? I want to pray for you. I believe Bobby's also singing about her own giftings. That's your own gifting, my baby. That's your own giftings. If you're here this morning and you were used in the gifts, but they need to be stirred, just listen to the word of the Lord. He says, "Come into my presence. Let him restir that gift. Let him restir that gift." Doesn't matter how long ago or when or what that is, come stir that gift. Gift of teaching, gift of exhortation, the spiritual gifts, prophecy, interpretation, the spiritual gifts. We need to refresh. When the Lord tells us, come, I will restore and I will refresh. Maybe there's someone here that you're not doing that. And I know. For you, my sweetie. I need some ushers here. Father, we thank you for Bob right now. Even more, we've seen the gift grow over the weeks and the months. But even more, my blessing. Even more, my blessing. Yeah, even more. Yeah, sit down. Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Diane, you and Jane, come pray. Megan, come pray. Lay your hands on her. Let that pastor or Jane, come pray for my mother. Come. There are women in the ministry. Just come. Lay your hands. And restore, restore, restore. Restore, restore, restore. Hallelujah. Is anybody else that's here this morning and just said, you know, I was used. And I let it slip. It doesn't matter what spiritual gift it was, prophecy, interpretation, tongues, whatever. If you're here this morning and you know God has gifted you, but you put it aside, I won't keep going over this unless there was somebody else who needed that. So, I was just singing it again. You may think that it's a pulpit ministry, not as such. Yeah. There's more of you have been used, and yeah, just close your eyes more. Oh, come on. Come on. Come on, Lord. Oh, stir their gift. You've seen some things before, Mike, but you're going to see them again. Father, stir. 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 Stir it. Stir it.
Hallelujah. Love amazes me, Lord.
Amazes me.
just the most amazing God. Oh, about you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Holy Spirit, where would you like us to do, Lord? Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Father, I thank you that I speak restoration. And there's those giftings and things that the enemy's tried to steal. But there's going to be increase, supernatural increase. And right now, Lord, as the enemy has tried to come against us and there is sickness and disease with some of our people, Lord, I just speak life over each and every person here this morning and those watching by live stream. Lord, that you get all the glory as you heal, particularly Mike's back. Heal. You heal Mark's ribs. Lord, right now, healed. Healed. Healed, Lord. Oh, we thank you for them. Thank you for Amanda and Tony, and thank you, Lord, Vicky, they're all healed. Healed and whole. Healed and whole, Lord. We expect good reports, Master. We expect good reports. Oh, your hand upon us. Thank you, Jesus. Well, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Why don't you go ahead and greet somebody. Welcome into the house. Welcome to our family this morning. Hallelujah, Jesus. Pass your communion cups down to the end of the center rows as well. Hallelujah. Communion cups to pass to the end of the rows, please, or the in center row. Well done, team. Hallelujah, Lord. We seem to have a... Is there any reason to... Oh, hello. Is there any reason the lights are not on the back? Can we put the lights on the back? We don't have lights at the back anymore. We always used to have lights at the back. I know you want to hide from me, but you can't. Is there any reason, David, we don't have lights at the back? Intensity hello, you think you can hide? Come on now. Someone put the light. I paid the bill, honest. Honest. We paid the bill. What's the matter? Lance, where are you? Go turn the lights on. Lance, hey, that's it. Hey, and then there was light. Hallelujah. It's just that I can see you all and wish you. Thank you all for being with us. And we have, hello, I had one of these. Nope. One of these. Oh, I've got a welcome live stream again. You're going to enjoy the service this morning, and I know you're new, and I want to just give this just a little welcome gift. And our brother, they were lovely to have you, so you've got one as well. Is anybody else I haven't seen for a while, apart from Tony running around under here? Everybody well? Awesome, awesome. Will you stop talking? Stop talking, man. Stop talking. I'm talking. Isn't God good to us? Well. I'm only kidding. For those of you who look at me, man, this is my wife. Honestly, it's fine. Amen. Well, Sean's going to come, and I've done the announcements. Remember, if you're here the first time, we'd love to have a cup of tea or coffee with you. And it's lovely to see you all with us. And we're going to have a wonderful time this morning. Sean, would you come and do?
Good morning, church. Just a quick remember that we've got two offerings today. One for the house and one to bless the man of God. Amen? Amen? During the week, I don't have a normal offering, but I've had this word, and Bobby confirmed so much this morning. And on Tuesday night at prayers, God put in my heart that there's limitations on his people, and he wants them removed. Amen? Because it's of the works of Satan. Amen? And there's so many people that is hope deferred. You've been doing the same thing. You've been sowing, or you've been sowing in part, then you don't do because you doubt it. And that's Satan's plan, because God is after consistency. Amen? You see, there's two things we need to know for the power of God to be activated in our lives. Number one, the will and testament. If it's in you, it's for us. Amen? So whatever is in you, we need to know, otherwise the enemy will deceive us. Amen? Then the second thing is that we become a doer of the word, not just a knower. I'm going to say that again. That we become a doer of the word and not just a knower. Amen? Because think about this. If the Bible says life and death is in the power of the tongue, if I'm speaking curses, if I'm gossiping, if I'm murmuring, if I'm complaining, what am I going to have? But if I speak life and life in abundance, if I speak blessing, if I speak over seed, what's going to happen? The same thing is going to happen with finances. If I mismanage finances, if I'm not a good steward of finances, what's going to happen? It's going to go out the back door. Whose fault? It's not even the devil's fault. It's my fault. But if I get into a point where I apply the principles of God and I start sowing and I start speaking over it and I be faithful, what's going to happen? Harvest, because I scatter. And the encouragement is this. In Genesis 26 verse 1, it said, and Isaac sowed in a time of famine. And God has been showing me there's many people, his people, the body of Christ, all over the world. Listen, not just here. That are going through a famine time. But it's in that time you've got to hold strong. You've got to stand. You've got to stand and be a doer of the word. Amen? Because if you go down to verse 12, it says, and he reaped a hundredfold in the same year. I think there's harvest coming to many that do not grow weary a hundredfold. That's what the Bible says. It's possible for you and me to reap a hundredfold in the same year. And I believe we're in a time where the soil is the most ripe it's been for generations in this time right now. For harvest of souls, for harvest of finances, because there's things we need to do. Amen? And that's the word I believe the Lord wants to say and encourage you. That you do not grow weary. That you scatter seed, that you speak over it and you water it and you command it. And where Satan is stealing from you, command him to pay back. Where you scatter seed, name the seed. Declare it for your business, for your venture, for funding, for whatever, favor. You've got to be speaking it, amen? Do you want to collect the offering? I'm tired of seeing limitations. There's vision sitting. We drove past the cemetery the other day. And I said to Megan, I said, listen, there's so many destinies and visions in that cemetery. Amen? How many of you want to go be buried one day and not have one thing that you have not accomplished for the Lord? And we've got to stop limitations. And we've got to become doers of the word. Amen? Do not grow weary. Stand. Speak it. Declare it. Gifts are going to get stirred. Businesses are going to be resurrected. Amen? We're going to be trading international, not just in Burley. That's where we've got to think. We've got to enlarge our 10 pigs. Okay, bring it forward if you got it. The devil is a liar. And we don't accept his lies in this church, amen? We're exposed to the thief. Thank you, Lord, for reminding me. Father, we just thank you right now, Lord, for resurrection power over each and every single seed, yeah, Lord. I thank you, your people that are weary, Lord. We're exposed to the thief. He is a liar, and he has no room in this house, Father, or any family that belongs to this house. And I thank you, Lord, for supernatural favor, Lord, that you will speed up harvest, that the harvest will overtake the sowing, Lord. And we declare that, Father, we decree it and we seal it with the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. There's no announcements.
There's no announcements? Okay, well, we won't do the announcements then. we're going. Second offering is that we're going to do that at the end of the service. The one thing I do want you to, we got a couple of things I do want to do. But first is, Pastor Joyce has been asked to head up a whole preaching to the nation of PNG of empowering the female youth of PNG. And it's from the 14th to the 16th. And if you know PNG, it's, her son's here, you'll know that this is a really great honor for her to do that. It's the 14th to the 16th of October. So what I'd like to ask you to do, maybe some of you can put your, just in your own prayer time, just ask Lord to bless her, amen, and be with her. What I'd like you to do is just put your Bibles down. And I want to ask you to stand. When I asked Cole to calm me, sit in, would you mind if I... It's the 100th year anniversary of the Light Horseman. And, oh, Lord. And when I look at what has happened in our nation and the debt that we owe to these men who gave up their lives, of all nations and our troops now, I just think, Lord God, we are so grateful. And it's funny, I'm not going to preach Cole's preaching, but I got to start something with prophecies next week about what's going to happen in Australia. This is the great South Land of the Holy Spirit. And you know what? Those men and women who have fought in the wars, and they didn't understand possibly what they were doing, but they were protecting us. And we need to honor that. And one of, and Cole, also, and I agree. I'd like you to bow your heads and close your eyes, and we're going to have 1 minute silence for us to remember and to thank in our hearts Jesus Christ for what he's done, but for what these men did for us. Thank you, Lord, right now. Thanks, everybody. What an awesome time.
Thank you. okay. Hey, put your hands together for Tom and for Phil. Yeah, time and their effort. Father, we're just so grateful for your grace, your favour that's on our lives, our homes, on our nation. And Father, we're just so grateful for that favour, for that protection, for that provision that you've given to our nation. It's not by might and it's not by power and it's certainly not by our brilliant intellects, but it's by your Spirit, Lord. It's by your Spirit. This is the Southland of the Holy Spirit. And we give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Praise God. What wonderful days to be alive and serving God. Is that right or not? Anyway, this is the 100-year anniversary of the landing on Anzac Spirit. Some people are not even familiar with that. But, you know, I was just thinking some time ago, my family's fought in every war almost that this nation's fought in. My grandfather rode with the light horse. My father fought in New Guinea on Kokoda. My mum's brother won the Military Cross on Kokoda. My son was with the armed forces in Timor, and my grandson currently serves in the army. But that doesn't mean, you know, that we're glorifying war. Let me just give you a scripture if we can before we go. Go to 2 Timothy with me if you would, and we'll just see what the Bible actually has to say. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, Paul writes, "You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that's in Christ Jesus." Not strong in yourself, but strong in the grace. "And these things that you've heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who'll be able to teach others." But verse 3 says, "You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." Is that what it says? And it goes on, "No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that they may please him and enlisted him as a soldier." You know, I understand in the church some people are pacifists and think that we, you know, shouldn't really stand up for anything. I don't find that in Scripture at all, particularly the New Testament. The only man Jesus ever commended for his faith was a Roman army officer. Is that right or not? Hello. He says, "I've not found faith anywhere in Israel like this man." So it's so wrong to stand up for your home and for your family, defend those things. Jesus should have ticked him off big time. He holds him up as an example. Paul talks in military terms. Fight the good fight of faith, the armor of God, salute your brother. They're all military terms. And this is the 100-year anniversary, you know. I believe the Anzac Day stops our nation possibly more than any other day. More than possibly Christmas Day. You know, that's just our nation. You can go anywhere you like in this country, to the biggest city, to the smallest country town. There'll be a pub, there'll be a police station, but there'll be an Anzac monument there somewhere. And on Anzac Day, there will be people. Is that right or not? So it just touches the heart of our nation. It really does touch the heart. You know, and if just thinking about Second World War, where we're under the threat of invasion by the Japanese, where those young Australians were the first to stop the Japanese armed forces. The first defeat ever inflicted on the Japanese army was not by Americans at Guadalcanal. Don't let facts get in the way of a good story. It was by young Australians at a place called Milne Bay. My father fought at Milne Bay. So, you know, you give honour where honour's due. The Bible talks about that. You know, I was thinking, what can we learn? What can I learn from my Anzac forefathers? If you ever get a chance to go to Kokoda, to Ishiraba, one of the most awful battles took place there, horrific battles. And you look out where these young Australians stopped the Japanese, outnumbered 10 to 1. Most of the young men had never fired a shot in combat ever, taking on an army that's never been defeated in combat. I believe it was the grace of God. Many of our commanders were actually born again, and they talk about going into their tents to pray. They need the wisdom of God because they don't have the answer. But you know, if you look out and it's just the Anzac Monument sums up in four words. One says courage, one says mateship, one says sacrifice, one says endurance. All of those are biblical principles. Every one of those things you can find Jesus exhibited on the cross. But you know, I just want to touch on one today, particularly one, because I believe it's lacking in our nation right about now. And if you go to John chapter 15, if you've got your Bibles, how many of you do believe the Bible? And this is Jesus speaking here. In John chapter 15, verse 13, he says, "Greater love has no one than this, than he lay down his life for his friends." Lay down his life for his friends. These young men lived by that principle. The code of the light horse was you never left a friend. You never left a mate under any circumstances. You never left your mates. You know, I pastored here in the United States, and I probably had 100 military officers in my church, and I've talked to most of them. Never one, not even one, has told me I found the same level of mateship in the church I found in the military. That's sad. That is very sad. And Jesus talks about laying down your life, not just inconveniencing yourself, but laying your life down for your friends. Mateship is a biblical principle. You can find it all the way through the Bible, all the way through Scripture. You can find they talk about friendship and mateship. Can I have an amen or what? You know, he's here. The Bible talks in Proverbs about a friend sticks closer than a brother. That tells me I can have friends that are even closer than my family. Sticks closer than a brother. Think about that. In an age, is that right? Really of selfishness and filler. Love's going to come now. What's the predominant sign of the last days? Yeah, probably blood moons. But more than that, it's men will be lovers of themselves. Do you know the average young person today takes 40 minutes of selfies a week? I didn't make that up. That's Time magazine. So 6 minutes a day. Don't you even know what you look like yet? Anyway, thank you for enthusiasm. We've never had a generation that took their own photo 6 minutes a day. I'm not being smart or rude. That's just a fact. Is that right? You know, we've got friends on there that every picture comes up, they're in it. I'm going, dear God, is that narcissistic or what? Anyway, thank you for your enthusiasm on that. But the Bible talks about friendship, a lot about friendship. Go to James with me. If you believe the Bible, well, let's look what the Bible actually says. Mateship. Second thing that the Anzacs were known for was mateship. You know, I did a book on the 800 horsemen. I interviewed an old light horseman back in the 80s. Queenslander, but he was in the territory. You know, and he said, you know, I saw my best friend shot off his horse. He said, against direct orders, I could be court-martialed. I wheeled my horse around. I'm galloping back. Against every bit of bullets are going over my head. He said, but I know my friend's back there. My mate's back there somewhere. He said, through the dust and through the smoke, I see someone lying on the ground. I galloped up and grabbed him by the belt and swung him up behind me. He said, when the dust settled, the smoke settled, he says, I realized I picked up a Turk by mistake. So I hit him on the head with my gun butt and I went back to find my friend again. Do you have a friend like that? Do you have a mate like that? Most of us don't even know our next door neighbors. I feel a love is going to come now. We build walls to cut ourselves off. You know, I saw the great T.D. Jakes. Hello, T.D. Jakes, Bishop T.D. Jakes, interviewed by Brian Houston. And he says, you know, Bishop, what would you like to be remembered for? Biggest church, greatest ministry, what would you be like? And Bishop thought for a moment. He said, Brian, I'd like to be remembered as a loyal friend in an age of relationship deficits. The thing we lack, I believe, is relationships. Genuine. You'll have many acquaintances in life, but very few friends. Very few friends. Friends, is that right? That are people you can trust. You can't have a friendship with someone that you don't trust. Is that right or not? Go with me here to James chapter 2. And in James chapter 2, we read here in verse 23, he's talking to Abraham. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God and was accounted him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. So even God is looking for friends. I hear people now, don't get all cranky. Hello, if you've got a religious spirit, it's about to manifest. I hear people say the primary, you know, reason we were saved is to worship God. I don't believe that. The primary purpose we were, saved was to serve God. I don't believe that. See, the Bible talks about family, God the Father. We're the children. Is that right? Sons and daughters. Hello. I didn't create my kids to worship me. I said, let's have some kids, Dan. They can stand outside our bedroom door, but worship us. Is this too deep? I didn't have my kids to serve me. We'll lay in bed, and you can bring us coffee in bed every morning at breakfast. I had my children, is that right? Because I wanted someone to love and to fellowship with. I didn't say we don't serve God. But I believe that God also wants us for fellowship. Adam and Eve talk with him, is that right? In the cool of the evening. Abraham is called the friend of God. Think about that, friend of God. And friends talk, is that right? Talk straight to each other. God's going to wipe out Sodom and Gomorrah, is that right? And Abraham starts chatting about it. You can't do that, is that right? Hello, think about this. You're negotiating with God. And what does God say? He says, will I not discuss what I'm going to do with my friend Abraham? Now, he didn't have to do that. He comes down to discuss what he's going to do. And Abraham says, well, you're going to wipe the city out for 50 righteous, 30. He could have got him down to one. Is that right or not? Friends with God. I love that. I don't know about you, but friendship. What's desperately lacking in our nation is real, true relationships. I don't mean to be rude. People suffer more from depression than any generation in our history. We pop pills and think it's completely normal. I'm talking about even in the church, suicide is rife. The number one killer of our young people, forget drugs and forget about accidents, our number one killer of young people is suicide. They take their own lives. Drugs, is that right? Domestic violence is off the Richter scale. What's just happened just here recently on the Gold Coast? Is that right or not? I'm just thinking. Terrorism, anyway. I'm just thinking. So, you know, friends, just being a friend of God. I love that. Friends have mutual confidence in each other. Can I have an amen? They trust each other. You can't have friendships with someone. Now, I don't mean to be rude. Is that right? You're going to have a lot of acquaintances, but very few friends. In a lot of cases, people want to be your friends. Is that right? For a selfish reason. They can see they can use you for something. Not a good basis for friendship. This is just me. I have a lot of acquaintances. I don't have many real good friends because you open yourself up with genuine friendship. Is that right or not? Genuine friendship. They negotiate. Abraham's talking with God about things like that. It's essential, I believe. Can I just say this? Particularly in ministry, do a lot with other pastors. I say it is essential. It may not be how well you can preach, sing, tap dance, whether you survive or not. It may be the value of your friends at the moment when you're down. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Value your friends. Listen to me. Value your friends. You know, pay the price, whatever's there. You know, I believe hold those friends in esteem. You know, as I say here, just think friends trust each other. Friends communicate with each other. Is that right? Jesus says, laying down your life, not just inconvenient, laying down your life for your friends. You know, we use the example of the military because I believe that's an awesome example of mateship. You know, William Mackenzie, a stockman, a chaplain, First World War, you know, gave his life to the Lord. He's in his 40s, ships out with the troops to the Middle East, sorry, to Gallipoli. He's in his 40s. Most of the young men in the armed forces are 17 and 18, some as young as 14. He's in his mid-40s. 4 years in frontline combat leads 3,500 young men to the Lord in combat. Full on relationships with Jesus because he was a friend to these young men. You know, the Battle of Lone Pine, we lost 2,500 young men in one day, 7 Victoria Crosses in one day. The first 3 waves have gone over, been shot down, they're wiped out, and the others are in the trench, they're about to go over, they ram their bayonets in the side, they know they're going to die. They hang their crosses and their love letters and their photographs because they're going to die. They know they're going to die. And Mackenzie's in the frontline trenches talking to them. And the commanding officer comes up and he says, "Chaplain, you're not even supposed to be in the front line. Get out." And Mackenzie, 6'5", stands up and says, "Sir, you and I both know these young men are going to die. What sort of a friend would I be if I leave them?" He says, "Sir, I'm not a rebellious person, but sometimes you've got to answer to a higher authority and you're not it." I'd follow a bloke like that. And he turns to these young men, he says, "I've lived with you, I've prayed with you, and I'm not afraid to die with you. And when the whistle blows and you go over the top, be right alongside of you." I got his diaries from the Salvation Army. Imagine that would mean to a 15-year-old kid that's never been off a farm in his life. The whistle blows, they go over, 700 are shot down. Mackenzie gets shrapnel in the back of both hands here and here. But he lives to survive to win a military cross. Should have been Victoria Cross. Summoned to Buckingham Palace by King George himself. And King George brushes through the generals and he says, "What you did, chaplain," says, "your fame precedes you. You were a friend to these young men." It's all about friendship, people. Bible talks about friendship. We can find it all the way through Scripture. David and Jonathan, think about it. Is that right or not? Here you got the heir to the throne and you got a bloke that still stinks of sheep dip. But they become lifelong friends there. Is that right? Their hearts are knit together. Is that right? Covenant relationships. You know when you meet somebody, isn't that right? That God says, you know, this can be a friend and someone that you can trust. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Later on, is that right or not? Jonathan so loves him, wants to give him his armor, things like that. But David and Jonathan, their hearts were knit together. And later on, Jonathan's killed in combat. And so David becomes king and he says, "Is there anybody left? Let me read it to you. Anybody left?" He says, "Of the household of Saul." Is that right or not? Let me read you the actual scripture. If I put it down, just give me a moment here. He says here, "Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because they loved him as their own soul. And Jonathan took off his robe and gave it to David with his armor, even his sword and his belt." And so later on in 2 Samuel, you find now Jonathan's dead. And David is king. And he says, "Is there anybody left of the household of Saul that I might show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Now, if there's anybody left, it's a threat to his throne. Is that right or not? And later on they find Mephibosheth. He lives out in Lodibar. Anyway, we won't go there. Is that right? And so they bring him in, and Mephibosheth's got a bad attitude. He doesn't like David because he thinks David was responsible for the injury that he got. And so David says, don't fear. He says, Mephibosheth, you put your feet under my table. I'll restore to you all of your lands and your fortunes, not because of who you are, but because of my love for your father, Jonathan. So true friendship goes beyond the grave, people, even beyond the grave. There's something we can learn from our Anzac forefathers that is severely lacking in modern life. It's called mateship. Just simple friendship. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You know, the more that I look at, I love this. Just reading some of the, I did this new book. It's called The Anzac Spirit. But let me read you a couple of things here. This is on the Battle of Kokoda. It says, the spirit of the Aussie mateship on Kokoda can be summed up by the actions of the diggers when they were wounded. After one particularly ferocious battle, 30 wounded were being evacuated when the sound of battle reached their ears again. Despite their wounds, the men turned around and struggled back up the track towards their endangered mates. And the medical officer said, you can't do that. They said, no, you never leave your friends. Of the 30 wounded diggers, only three never returned. One was blind, one had lost an arm, and the other had lost part of his face. Everyone else turned back to their friends. You never leave a friend. Jesus said, is that right? Laying down your life. Not just inconvenience, laying down your life. We find it all the way through Scripture. Think of it. Let me show you a couple of Scriptures here. Go with me to 2 Timothy. Here, how many of you believe the Bible? I love Timothy. I love the way Timothy writes. Timothy's my sort of bloke. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, he writes in verse 15, these you know that all of those in Asia have turned away from me. Everybody's left me. Among those Phygeles and Hermogenes, the Lord grant mercy to the household of Onesiphorus. Who is this bloke? Never heard of him. Hello? But his name's in the Bible forever. Your name may be in the Lamb's Book of Life. It ain't in the Bible. This man's name's in the Bible. He never preached. He never built a great church. Hello? You get to heaven. And this is first. What's your, how come your name's in the Bible, Jack? What did you do? Sing, tap, dance, play the banjo? He says, I was a friend of Paul. I possibly kept the Apostle Paul in ministry. It goes on to say here, if I read this rightly, the Lord grant mercy to the household, not just the Onesiphorus, but bless his whole family. Is that right? For he often refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chain. When he arrived in Rome, he sought me out very zealously and found me. The Lord grant to him that he might find mercy from the Lord in that day. And you know very well how many ways he ministered to me, he says, at Ephesus. Let's get this straight. Onesiphorus lives in Ephesus, but he visits Paul in Rome. Have a look on a map what that would mean in a journey today. And when you went to the Roman jail, they could lock you up. But he's not afraid. He's not ashamed. Everybody else has turned away. Am I reading this right? Everybody else has left him, but Onesiphorus comes. The word Onesiphorus here, if I jotted it down, it actually means to refresh. It means to bring profit. I love that. Think about that. You know, his name is, Paul's name's mentioned, what, 165 times? Onesiphorus just a couple of times. But it's in the Bible forever. Why? Because he was a friend to Paul. Paul needed a friend. If you go to Philippians with me here, another one in Philippians chapter 2. In Philippians chapter 2, and reading from verse 25, it says, yet I considered it necessary to send you Epaphroditus. These blokes have got names 3 feet long. Well, they can't be just Fred and Jack. Anyway, Epaphroditus, my brother, my fellow worker, my fellow soldier, your messenger, the one who ministered to my need. Since he was longing for you all, he was distressed because you heard that he was sick. Indeed, he was sick almost unto death. But God had mercy on him, not only on him, but also on me, lest I would have sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I sent him more eagerly, and when you see him again, rejoice, and I may be sorry. Look what he says in verse 29. Receive him, therefore, in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such men in esteem. Friends to Paul. The great apostle Paul needed friends. You and I need friends, people. Is that right or not? We live lonely lives. You know, a lot of people, when they're about to die, you visit them in hospital. Nobody says, I wish I had more money. But I hear people say, I wish I never lost my family. I wish I never, you know, forgot my friends. Can I have an amen or what? Lifelong relationships, laying down your life for your friends. It's going to take some effort. Friends communicate. Is that right or not? Hello? Remember the days we actually used to talk to each other? Hello, is that right? Friends, communicate. You don't even have to be next door, but you can pick up your phone. What's going on? What's happening with you? Can I have an amen or what? Friends, communicate. Isn't that right? Abraham and God communicated. Adam and Eve communicated in the evening. Is that right? Things like that. Friends communicate regularly, but they communicate from the heart. We can talk. Is that right? See, you trust someone. Hey, my wife's not much of my wife. She's my best friend. Why? Because also I trust her. I might not listen to you, but I'll listen to her. Can I have an amen? Someone just come along and, you know, build you up real big. Is that right? I heard somebody say, never listen to your critics or the people that build you up big. They both tell lies. But you listen to someone that you trust. Can I have an amen? Why? Because I trust this person. They're not just trying to put me down. It's not that you know, they trust each other. You know, since we've I better watch what I say. But since we've been touched, you know, particularly by the grace message, change my life, change. I'm different. I'm a different person. I feel like I'm born again. I bought my wife these beautiful bathers the other day, you know, because she liked them. And that, right? You know, we're down somewhere, and she went out, and I went and negotiated and bought them. I wouldn't have done that a few years ago. I'd just get something off from Kmart. That'll hurt, you know. But God has changed me. It really has touched me. And so I got a really good friend, and you'd know his name, but I'm not going to go in, from the United States, and he doesn't like the grace message. Now, this is just him. And so, you know, we discuss things, and he's quite verbal the way he puts it out. So I hadn't seen him for a couple of years. He comes to do some meetings in Australia, and I rang him up, and I said, I'll call him Fred. It's not Fred, but I said, hey, Fred, let's go for coffee. He said, I didn't think you'd want to see me. I said, can we go out to lunch? So we sat down to lunch. I said, listen to me, Fred. We've been friends a long, long time. It goes back many, many years, and that friendship is valuable to me. I said, you know, I said, just because we see things slightly differently now, you know, if I came to your church, I wouldn't preach that. Hello? Because I know that it would possibly offend you. I said, that friendship is very dear to me. I'm not about to let 25 years of friendship go like that. Whatever it takes. He looked at me, he said, I'm so glad you said that. He said, the next time you come to the States, will you preach for me again? See, listen to me. Friends trust each other. If I knew that Pastor Ian didn't like speaking in tongues, what sort of a moron would I be to get up here and speak on tongues? Give it a good shot, because you ain't coming back. Is that too deep? Give it your best go, because you ain't coming back again. Hello. Is that right? Friends trust each other. And, you know, communicate regularly. But they trust each other. I like that. That trust. You know, that's why the military, they trust each other. If you look at the guys that win the Victoria Cross, what do they say? I'm responsible for my friends. What's the 6'7" bloke, you know, that I can't think of his name, that won Victoria Cross? When he won that, he says, I thought they were going to hurt my friends. It's all about somebody else, not about me winning great big medals or something like that, but laying down your life for each other. You know, if you're going to have friendships, you can't have selfish motives. Can I have an amen or what? You know, Proverbs. Go back to Proverbs with me quickly. Proverbs chapter 17 again. How many of you still believe Scripture? Proverbs 17 verse 7. A friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. You know, somebody comes along and they confess something to you. That's not your opportunity to go out and blab it to everybody else. If someone trusts you enough to come, isn't that right? Pray for them, help them. Come on, we can get through this thing together. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? You know, that we begin to trust each other. My best friend pastors my old church in Darwin, Don Dawson, years ago is my associate pastor. And so he goes out and leads this young lady to the Lord. She's living a de facto relationship, shacked up. Is this, I'm politically correct, as you can pick it up. Okay, thank you. Anyway, so, you know, they're living together, and she goes home, tells her boyfriend. The boyfriend goes nuts and belts her up, puts her in hospital, and then threatens he's going to kill us. Oh, how many know? If you're not called to ministry, anyway, we won't go there. So I get a phone call. Saturday morning, I get a phone call. The man's on his way to shoot me. Jen's gone. She's got the car. She's gone shopping for the day. She's got a black belt in shopping. She's off shopping for the day. No, just food shopping. Hello. I'm home with my four kids and my Labrador dog. What am I going to do? The guy's on the way to shoot me. Hello. Now, if you've got a religious spirit, it's about to manifest. Trust me. I'm thinking, who am I going to ring? I got my father-in-law. Take the kids. Go down the park. I said, I didn't tell him why. Don't come back until I tell you. I thought, now, if I ring some spiritual airhead that tells me he's going to pray for me over the phone, I'm going to throw up. Now, I'm not against prayer. But if you're going to pray for me, have the guts to come and stand alongside of me. It's a lonely place to be. Don't pray over the. Come and stand here, right here. We'll pray together. And I rang my mate and I said, Don, the bloke's on the way to shoot me. The phone goes dead. This is great. The phone's dead. 15 minutes later, here, four-wheel drive coming down the Stuart Highway in Darwin. Four-wheel drift into my driveway. Door slammed. Up the stairs and my mate runs in. He says, where's the bloke? We're lifelong friends. Lifelong friends, people. If I'm going through a bit of a problem, I said, Don, I've got some problems with the family. I'm too emotionally involved. He said, I'll be on a plane tomorrow. Do you have a friend like that? Most of us don't have a friend like that. If you don't have a friend like that, you need to be a friend like that. You don't have friends, the Bible says, because you don't show yourself friendly. Is that right? See, friends communicate. They actually listen to each other. There's a novel idea today. While you're texting and everything else, actually listening to somebody, putting the phone down. Anyway, thank you for your enthusiasm. But friends actually communicate. Abraham, he says, I not discuss with my friend what I'm about to do. I love that. As I'm looking there, a friend of God, Jesus, called the disciples. He says, I don't call you disciples anymore. I call you friends. John chapter 16, he says, I call you friends. So friends can even be closer than blood relationships. Closer, is that right? I believe that. Lay down your life for your friends. Bless your friends. I believe that friends bless each other. I go out sometimes and I go to eat with people with places I don't like what they eat. I don't even like what Jen likes. She likes taboon and all that camel poo and all that sort of stuff they eat. You know, thank you for your enthusiasm. I don't like it. I'm not into that, but she loves it. Why do I go? Because she likes it. Can I have an amen? Amen. If it was just what I want to do all the time, how many? No, that's no relationship. What would you like to do? Where would you like to? And it's exactly the same thing. Bless your friends. Can I have an amen or what? As I say here, just think about that. We've not found that same level of mateship in the church. That's what bothers me. That they found in the military. Lay their lives down for each other. My wife doesn't like me talking about it, but when it's your turn to minister, you can do it your way. Years ago, one of her best friends dying of cancer, she led her to the Lord. And so she goes to visit her in hospital and she rings me up and she's crying. She said, honey, I'm here with my friend and my friend's dying and we're here on our own. She said, I don't want my friend dying on her own. That's no way to go. So she said she's got her own ward. So I asked the doctor to wheel another bed into the ward. And I asked, can I stay here? I'll sleep here. I'll eat here. Because if my friend dies, I don't want to die on her own. So she rings me at 3 o'clock in the morning and she's crying and she said, honey, my best friend's just gone to heaven and we're sitting here holding hands, worshiping God. She said, but where's her family? Something is wrong. Is that right? I mean, in an age of a relationship, her own daughter rang her up and said, why don't you hurry up and die, Mum, so I can get on with my life. I'm not making it up. You don't got to make up stories like that. She'll regret that one day. But it makes me realize what sort of society we live in today. I heard the Prime Minister, you know, the new Malcolm Turnbull, what he actually said. He's talking about domestic violence. He says, unless we go back to grassroots level and we begin to teach our young people, is this correct or not? He said, there is no hope. There is no answer unless we go back and we start again at grassroots. I remember growing up with respect. Is that right or not? Hello. My dad wasn't even a Christian for except the last 10 years. My mum and dad were married to each other for 72 years. If I swore in front of my mother, my clothes would have been out of date when I woke up. My dad believed in time travel, would have punched me in the middle of next week. He said, if you can't respect your mother as your mother, respect her as my wife, but you will respect her. My wife has a lot of input with my grandsons. You will respect your mother. You will respect. And both of my grandsons, they're big blokes, 6'3", one's in the army. But they hug us. They open the door for their mother. Hello, because that's the way they're brought up. Jen said, you may grow up with some problems, but wife bashing won't be one of them. I guarantee you that. You will respect. Is that hello? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anyway, thank you for your enthusiasm. And so we go back and we look at these men. Maybe a generation, but they lay down a foundation that we are fast losing. Courage, mateship, sacrifice, endurance, biblical principles. Can I have an amen or what? These young men, we thought they're fighting for country, but they actually admit they were fighting for their friends, for each other. to protect their friends, to protect them. Imagine if we could get that into the church. As I say here, Paul is talking in those terms here. He's talking about Onesiphorus. He's talking about Aphrodite. He's talking about, is that right? Look at 2 Timothy quickly with me. Just a couple of scriptures and we need to close 2 Timothy and 2 Timothy chapter 4. And Paul, I love the way Paul writes, and this is what he says in verse 14. He says here, Alexander the coppersmith did me much harm. Hello, there might be some people in the church. Is that right? Hallelujah, praise God, hands worshipped up, but you can't trust them with a loaded shotgun. Is this too deep? Not this church, another church somewhere else. Is that right or not? I might have been born at night, but not last night. Hello? He says here, he did me much harm. May the Lord repay him according to his works. You also must be aware of him, for he has greatly resisted our words. At my first events, no one stood with me. Excuse me, no one. This is the great apostle Paul. But all forsook me. May I not be charged against them? But the Lord stood with me and strengthened me so that the message might be preached fully through me and all the Gentiles might hear and I'd be delivered out of the mouth of the lion. And the Lord will deliver me from every evil work and preserve me in his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory in ever and ever. Greet Priscilla, Aquila, and the household of Onesiphorus. And there it is again. A man we've never heard of. Never preached great messages, never led that. No, don't say that. Never built great churches, but his name is in the Bible forever. I like that. God is smarter than you and me because he was a friend to Paul. What we desperately need in these last days are friends, genuine friends. I tell the young ministers that we're raising up, I said, the difference, whether you survive or not, may not be how brilliant you can preach or sing or tap dance. It may be in the caliber of the friends that you make. Because when you're down, the Bible says, woe to him that if he falls alone. There better be somebody there to come alongside of you. Is that right or not? That you're depressed or you want to quit. Hey, I've been there. Hello. Let me close off with this. Years ago, Jan doesn't like it, but anyway, must be God because he just reminded me. Anyway, but I had a man in my church that raped two girls and murdered them. From my church, not somebody I read at my church. And was sitting in my church on a Sunday after he killed these girls. He's still in Darwin jail to this day. And later on, when he gets caught out and he confesses and he holds his Bible up and says, God told him to do it. All hell broke loose. I nearly lost my church. And you know, and people are ringing me up and they say, oh, we were the Kenneth Copeland cult of Darwin. They wouldn't have me on their finger for a wart, most of the pastors. But now they're putting it around. He was my youth director, my music director. Don't let facts get in the way of a good story. Been in my church a couple of months. Anyway, I got really cranky. And Jim the Baptist, not John the Baptist, Jim the Baptist rang me up. I don't even know Jim the Baptist. Jim doesn't even speak in tongues. And he rang me up and I just slammed. I don't want to speak to you. And he rang me back and he said, don't hang up on me. He said, I'm coming to get you and I'm taking you for a cup of coffee. Oh, okay, you can pay for the coffee right over there. He sat down and he said, Cole, he says, I know you're a man of God. We may not even agree on everything doctrinally, but I know you're a man of God and you need a friend. And God told me to be your friend. And this is what he said to me. If you've got to make a statement to the press, you put my name in my church and I'll back you to the limit. He said, if you've got to need money, my church, hey, Pete the Pentecostal wants to kick me in the head and Jim the Baptist wants to be my friend. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Years go by, is that right? This is not, I'm talking about lifelong friendships that can stand the test of time. They may not even be in the same denomination as you. God knits you. David and Jonathan were from different sides of the track, but their hearts were knit together. They become lifelong friends. And years later, Jim gets himself in a bit of a problem, not because he did anything wrong. And so I went to my board and I said, Jim needs some money for his building fund. They said, we've got our own building fund. I said, listen to me. I said, where were you when the flak was flying? I didn't remember seeing you stand alongside of me. Is this too deep? I said, he's the only one that supported me. I said, if I don't, you give me the, I want a check for $5,000. That was a lot of money those days. I said, if you don't give me, I'll get it from somewhere, but I will get the money. They wrote me the check. I worked around, knocked on the door, and the associate pastor came out, didn't like Pentecostals, wouldn't have had me on his finger for a wart. Looked at me and said, what do you want? I said, money. He said, brother. Money speaks all, oh, brother. I said, where's Jim the Baptist? And he said, in his office. I said, you get him. He walked around and I flicked the check over and I said, Jim, that'll get you out of your problem. And he started to cry. He said, my own church. I said, listen to me. You're the only one that stood with me in that moment. I said, I would have quit the ministry. I was ready to quit. I was ready to walk away. thinking they're all idiots. I don't want anything more to do with this. I said, you're a friend to me. You're an Onesiphorus to me. You're an Aphrodite. He started to cry. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah. Lifelong friendships. Doesn't matter what your denomination is. I got friends that don't see this exactly the same. You know, my best friend, Don Dawson, he heads up the Assemblies of God. I said, you'll be all right when they cast that spirit out of you. He says, you'll be all right when you get saved. I mean, we're just friends. Hello, friends can joke with each other. Is that right? We can actually communicate with each other. Rings me up. Is that right? He's got to go in for an operation, so I want to be there. I want to drive. I want to be there. Hello, anybody know what I'm talking about? Yes. Lay down your life for your friends. Not just inconvenience yourself, but lay your life down for your family, for your, is that right, for your spouse. I mean, hello, in these days and age, I believe, we desperately need people that understand friendship. Jesus said, I don't call you disciples, I call you friends. Abraham was the friend of God. I love that. Can I have an amen? Amen. What can I learn from my Anzac forefathers? I can learn something about courage in a world that knows very little about courage. I can learn something about mateship in a world that's very selfish and individualistic. I can learn something about sacrifice and endurance. I can learn something from my Anzac forefathers. First the natural and then the spiritual. I want you to stand up real quickly with me. Come on, stand up. I want to just show you a little DVD if we can. This is a visual generation. I go to schools all the time. Talk. You know, it's a visual generation. You have to have something visual to impact this generation. And I believe this is just a mark of respect. Of what we can learn from our Anzac forefathers. Can you play that for me, please? We got sound?
So you've knocked off for a spiker, and you'll be back later on. Hey, true blue. Hey, true blue. Give it to me straight, face to face. Are you really disappearing? Just another dying race. Hey, true blue. True blue. Is it me and you? Is it mom and dad? Is it a cockatoo? Is it standing by your man when he's in a fight? Or just Vegemite? True blue, I'm asking you. Can you bear the load? Will you tie it up with wire just to keep the show on the road? Hey, true blue. Hey, true blue. Never be fitting. Is your heart still there? If they sell us out like sponge cake, do you really care? Hey, true blue. True blue. Is it me and you? Is it mom and dad? Is it a cockatoo? Did it stand by your mate when she's in a fight? Or just Vegemite?
Let me just read you this. This is one of the young, one of the men that fought on Kokoda. I emphatically believe in looking after number one. But number one's not yourself, it's your best mate. The feeling that genuine mateship gives you when you're at the bottom of the barrel, and along comes your friends. Often they don't say anything, they just sit down with you. It's like a husband and a wife holding hands on one another's deathbeds. In a time of crisis, words aren't necessary, just be there. Father, we just give you praise and we give you glory. I thank you for the men, the women of the church here, Lord. I thank you for Pastor Ian and Diane. And Father, I believe that the days ahead will be trying days, but they'll be exciting days. And Father, I believe what we desperately need again is that spirit of mateship. You called Abraham your friend. Jesus, you called the disciples friends. Father, I remember sitting in a church one time and you spoke to me and said, I don't only love you, I like you. I like you. Father, it's an honor to be called friends. You call us friends. I speak a blessing over this church. I call them the head and not the tail, and not and above and not beneath. That whatever they turn their handship to shall prosper and succeed. That the enemy shall no longer find opportunities to rob and to kill and destroy. Our homes, our families, Lord, we just thank you, are off limits to the devil. We just give you the praise and the glory. Father, give us that revelation as Paul had great esteem for Onesiphorus and Epaphroditus, that we'd value our friends, place great value on our friends and our relationships, and not just take it for granted. Friends communicate with each other. Friends trust each other. Friends speak to each other frankly. Father, I just thank you for the homes, the families that are represented here now in Jesus' name. While your head's about and nobody's looking around just for a moment, is there anybody here this morning that you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord? I'm not asking you to join a church. I'm asking you to pass from the kingdom of darkness into the family of God. But you come to the realization you don't have what it takes to make it on your own. But sooner or later you realize, whatever, I don't have what it takes to make it on my own. I not only need a Lord and Savior, I need friends. Friends I can trust. Is there anybody here this morning, just pop your hand up and say, I need Jesus as my Lord. I need that, Pastor. Please pray for me. Please pray for me. Anybody. I won't drag you down the front. I won't embarrass you. I'll pray for you right where you're standing. All you need to do is signify by slip your hand up. And I'll pray for you right where you're standing. Anybody at all? Maybe some people watching on live streaming. Anyone at all? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, then, we just give you the praise and the glory. We worship you, Lord. What awesome days it is to be alive and serving you, Lord. Father, come to the realization, you're not just my Lord and Savior, you're my friend, my best friend. You tell me exactly what's going on in my life. Father, we worship you, but we place great value on our other friends, our spouse, our close friends. Father, we just give you the praise and we give you the glory. I thank you for my forefathers, that Anzac spirit that flows in the blood of this generation now. Same blood, same spirit that flowed through their veins is flowing through this generation's veins as well. Maybe not that we would have to do something in the physical. I believe it'll be in the spiritual. But we need that same Anzac spirit of courage and mateship and sacrifice and endurance. What can I learn from my Anzac forefathers? I can learn to be a better man, a better father, a better husband, and a better Christian. Let's give the Lord a clap offering. Can we do that? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Pastor.
Before we dismiss, if you just want to go, let's be seated for a second. I want to receive an offering into Col's ministry. If you'd like to prepare your hearts for sighing, it's an awesome basic message. Hey, back to basics. He realizes we got the best church in the world as well. Wouldn't want to be anywhere else. Great bunch of friends, great kind people. wonderful people. Remember, make sure when you leave from here that if you can have some friend fellowship, which is wonderful, but also make sure if there's somebody you haven't met before, go say hi. You never know what a kind word will do in somebody's life. I preached this a couple of weeks ago, didn't I? Kind people live in a kind world and mean people live in a mean world. And Col and Jan are the kindest people. Well, Jan is anyway. Col's a little, but he's a friend. I can know he's fine. But I want you, this is Col's new book. Col never ever comes asking us for anything. He just comes and wants to serve us as a church. And we've been friends now since we've been here for 18 years now. And for those of you who know me, I had hair when I first met him. And he had black hair, maybe. But I want to just say to encourage you, if you've got your offering ready, can we come and take the offering up for the church? And he's got this book, and I think he's got the another product out there, resource out there. Please go ahead and purchase it. Go and clear the books out so he can go away with everything sold. He's a wonderful, wonderful writer, as I say. And I did teach him most of what he knows, and Jan taught him the rest. So it's wonderful. Amen. We've got a great team. We're going to go. When you've just given into the offering, remember I tell you again that everything that comes in goes directly into their ministry. It won't be, there's nothing taken out. We're going to give an offering from the church. But you have a chance to sow seed into that good soil. Amen. Are we all done with that? Can I want to pray over it and bless it to your account? And then we'll stand. Is that done? Why don't you go ahead and stand? You got one, bring the offering down the front here for us. Are we all ready? Are we all done? Hallelujah. Come on, we'll lay hands on it and bless it to the givers. Do you enjoy that word? I did. I mean, yeah. Why he gets invited back, I don't know. But this is just a wonderful, wonderful man. Stretch your hands out to the seed. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to sow seed into Col and Jan's life, into their ministry. And I declare over this the seed that it will produce a harvest. But we do it with knowledge that it's going into good soil, because Col and Jan are people of absolute integrity and character, Lord. We thank you. They give us examples to follow. And we give you praise for that. We give you praise for the harvest that it's going to bring in our lives and in their life, in Jesus' name. Everyone said, amen. Hallelujah. We're going to worship God as we go, or whatever you have planned. And then we'll see you on Tuesday and Thursday for prayer, Wednesday, worship practice. And please, as we dismiss in a moment, please go and have some wonderful fellowship. Amen.
Your love.
Your love. It amazes me, your love has lifted me higher than I can possibly dream. Your love amazes me. Your love, it amazes me. Your love has lifted me higher than I can possibly dream. Your love amazes me.
And your love,
your love, it amazes me, your love has lifted me higher than I can possibly dream. Your love amazes me.
God bless you, church. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you next Sunday. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, your love amazes me. Hallelujah, your love Your love amazes me. Hallelujah. Your love amazes me. Hallelujah. Your love amazes me. Hallelujah. Your love amazes me.
It amazes me, your love has lifted me higher than I can possibly dream. Your love amazes me.